Greetings, Earthlings. Another quick inbox review for you here, this one of a new kit from Hobby Boss, the Soviet SS-23 Spider tactical ballistic missile. Now, the Spider, or Oka as it was officially known, had quite a short history, but an interesting one. And it was actually conceived as a replacement for the venerable Scud missile, which came out in the 1950s. And the Scud had a crew of, I think, 7 men, and took anything from an hour to 90 minutes from stopping the vehicle to actually launching the missile. It also wasn't particularly reliable in terms of actually hitting a target. I suppose accurate is a better word than reliable. And its range wasn't particularly great. Its range was only about, I think, 300 kilometres or something. So the Soviets needed a new vehicle, a new missile system, and this is what they came up with. So this was a big advance, I should say, on the Scud. Whereas the Scud needed, as I say, a crew of about 7, they all had to dismount from the vehicle and go about their various duties in order to launch the missile, almost by definition there'd be a nuclear war going on, so they would probably need to wear NBC gear. It was difficult and time consuming and very unpleasant for the crew, and that didn't make it a particularly useful weapon system because it was just so hard to use. The Oka, as the Soviets called it after the river, the Oka was a completely new setup. It used a solid fueled rocket, which meant that all of the tedious refueling of very flammable and volatile liquid fuels was taken out of the way. It also had a crew of only 3, and in order to launch the missile, they didn't need to get out of the cab. So basically, everything that was needed to launch the missile was included inside the cab. So a much more comfortable and more efficient system, and it meant that they could actually, from stopping the vehicle, they could actually launch one of these in about half an hour. So considerably better than the old Scud. Added to that, it had a much improved range. The actual real range isn't really known, but NATO analysts believe that it had a range of about 450 to 500 kilometres. Although the Soviets at the time insisted that it had a range of only about 250 kilometres, which seems rather low. The reason it had such a short history was that when the INF sort of nuclear arms limitation treaties came into being in the 1980s, excuse me, this was one of the missile systems targeted by NATO, who said, you know, we want you to get rid of these. We're going to get rid of the Pershing missiles. The Pershing was basically deployed in opposition to these. But they said, we'll get rid of the Pershing. You need to get rid of the SS-23. Now, the official line from the Soviets was, well, this doesn't fall under the terms of the INF treaty because it has too short a range. It's only a 250 kilometre range. It's a short range sort of missile. It's tactical rather than sort of semi-strategic or in theatre. It doesn't. We're not going to do anything about it. In the end, as a show of good faith, Gorbachev decided to scrap these missiles. So fair play to him. He did that, and obviously decided that it was better to keep the goodwill of NATO than it was to. Just to keep some missiles that would probably soon be superseded anyway. However, that wasn't quite where it ended, because the Soviets actually sent a few of these in secret to some of their Warsaw Pact satellite countries, like, I think, Bulgaria. And they were sort of stored there in secret and not scrapped with the rest of them. But eventually, with the fall of the Soviet Union, the Bulgarians admitted that they had them, and these, I think, have been scrapped now as well. So, in fact, there are very, very few of these left. There are, I think, 2 or 3 in museums around the world. All the others have been very visibly scrapped. The rockets have been taken away and cut up and detonated. Not nuclear detonation, but packed with explosives and then blown up. So these are quite a rare beast, and they're only in service really for a couple of years. So quite a short-lived system, but a very interesting one. So the system itself uses this rather Thunderbirds-looking amphibious eight-wheeled chassis. The missile is in this fully enclosed container on the back. It's all very space age, and it's interesting. I think interesting subject for a kit. So let's have a look and see what the kit actually shows us. Talk amongst yourselves. Okay, what have we got? Right, first of all, obligatory gubbins. An advert for the kit that we're already actually looking at, which seems a little bit superfluous, but there we go. And we have a painting guide. It has two schemes on here, one in this kind of grey slatish colour, and it says middle stone, but that looks more like green to me, and another one in this looks like general sort of Russian green with very thin black stripes over it. I'm very dubious about this one because I think that actually these would be different colours. I don't see any tactical advantage to painting very, very thin stripes over it because you wouldn't see them. Now this one I think is actually the Bulgarian scheme. I could be wrong on that, but I seem to remember seeing that as the Bulgarian vehicle. So none of those fancy schmancy MiG ammo productions colour sheets on this one. It's just the normal hobby bus one. But having said that, it's very nice to have a proper four colour sheet. And on to the instructions. I'm not going to go through these in too much minute and tedious detail because, you've seen a set of instructions before. But I'll just quickly go through just to say there's the cab with the sort of launch gear and sort of a screen here for that shows the sort of the map of the launch and target areas. So some seats and bits and pieces. These are the I'm not quite sure. I think that's a tracking radar. But these bits here are the hydraulic ends for the jacks that hold the vehicle steady. More stuff there and launch gear for the inside of the cab. We get to some very interesting things. There are loads of these little tiny photo etch bits on here. Let's see if I can zoom in. That is like a little tiny boot scraper. And it looks very straightforward. It says PEB7 and it says times 46. So those have to be bent into a little sort of L shape there. I hit that 46 times, whereupon probably you can, well, entitled to have a bit of a lie down and a cry. So those are all over the top of the vehicle. I suppose they're just there to stop inattentive crews from sliding off it in the snow or whatever. Yes, there's a lot of photo etch on here, and it's unfortunately of a very small and tedious kind. Then we get the sort of thrusters that control it in the water, the wheels and tyres, and we're onto the suspension. It's unusual because it doesn't start with the suspension, it starts with the cab. But the suspension fits onto this kind of sealed chassis here. It seems to have a sort of a torsion bar suspension in much the same way as the Scud. I suppose these things all use very similar technologies. And then it gets fitted to the main hull. And more tricking out, fitting the wheels. Now I don't think I'm going to do this quite in this order because I think that putting all of these delicate bits on before I've actually got the hull halves together is going to mean that all the stuff is going to get broken. So I think I'm going to be a bit more circumspect. Then there's the missile itself in several parts. Very nice nozzles here. It has these strange waffle iron type control flaps. So rather than fins like missiles often had, these sort of waffle iron things would fold out, and they would they would swivel in order to control the vehicle. Very unusual design. Okay, so the missile fits onto the launcher, and the launcher fits into the tray that goes inside the vehicle, and then there are some sides here for the inside of the vehicle. This, I think, is rather simplified. Based on the very scant references I've found of the vehicle, I think that's quite simplified. In particular, things like the pipes and cables and things on the walls are all rather simplified and could probably do with being scraped off and rebuilt from tube or something. And then we get to some fun parts. All around the vehicle there are these tiny photo etch parts. It says here make 8, but these are little tie downs, I think, for show you what these are like. There we are, it's a little tie down for I think for a canvas cover. And again, there are about 48 of these in total to be made. So again, that's gonna be pretty tedious. Each one of those is kind of U-shaped, so you need to bend it twice, and also you need to fit a little bit of brass wire in between the two sides to make the tie downs. And then we're back to the interior, and we're fitting this thing. This thing here is like a heated cowling that mounts in the bottom of the launch bay, and it was intended to keep the nuclear warhead, if one was fitted, at a particular temperature. Apparently nuclear warheads need to be kept at a sort of constant temperature. I'm not quite sure why. Maybe they don't hatch or something. I don't know. And then there's the hatches here that go on the top of the vehicle. And then finally putting all the bits together with loads of more of these little tie downs going along the side. And then the obligatory stand back and admire it sections. So there are 27 sections, including the haven't I done this well, isn't it nice? Okay, and with the instructions out of the way, let's take a look at the bits of plastic. What are in the box? Well, first of all, let's have a look at the bigger bits. This, no prizes for guessing, is the cap. Like everything in here, it's moulded in this sort of tan plastic. Yes, leading to the old joke, Hobby Boss kits are absolutely tan plastic. And looks fairly nice, quite crisp. Nice indeed. There's a bit of copper wire as well included. To zoom out a bit for this one, this is the main lower hull, sort of big boat-shaped lower hull. A big hole here where the sort of chassis will go. Again, quite nice, large, crisp moulding. Some sort of, I think these are refueling points and what have you for the vehicle and the missile. And they're very, very nicely done. They really are. It's lovely, crisp moulding. Quite impressed. So again, as you can see, quite a big vehicle when it's made up. And this is the chassis, as it were. On the scud, this is made of sort of nice metal sort of sections, kind of held together with tubular ties. I expect on the real vehicle it's very much the same, but that obviously it's covered in this sort of waterproof shroud. Again, there's lots of points here for, I don't know, lubrication, I suppose. And the inspection hatches. A very, very nice, crisp piece of moulding once again. So far, really very good. This is the top of the rear hull. This hole here is where the missile is deployed and launched from. And there's lots of holes around it for hatches and vents and bits and pieces that'll be added later. The obligatory, the obligatory Hobby Boss rubber tyres, hateful things. These actually don't look too bad. They've got a very nicely rendered pattern on them. The seam doesn't look too bad at all. They're survivable. These are the nozzles, or the, at least the engine section for the missile. Very sensibly rendered in two parts like this, so that you won't get a nasty seam down the edges. So the transparent bits for the windows. The etch set from hell. You can see these are the sort of boot scrapery bits. These are the tie downs. These are the grills that go over the front headlamp assemblies. And if I focused on that, you'd be able to see even better. And then there's another sheet on the back there with grills for the side panels and more tie downs and bits and pieces. A decal sheet here, not very many decals, a couple of unit markings, and this is like a map that, to simulate the map that appears in the commander's display, and some gauges for the driver's instruments. Further bits are these. We've got two identical sprues here that contain parts for the wheels, the hatches for the cab, some suspension unit parts. Basically, I think anything that happens twice on the real vehicle is on these sprues, so there's two sets of them, I think. Now, there are four of these sprues. These contain more wheel parts, as well as more suspension and transmission parts. Again, very crisp, really not bad at all. Hobby Boss have come along quite nicely in their moulding quality, I think. See if I can zoom any further on that. No, I can't. Those are the grills. They do have a name. They're something like Berezhtovsky grills or something. I've probably got that wrong. But they're a particular design that's used, I think, quite often on Soviet vehicles, or Soviet missiles, I should say. Some big honking springs here. Damper struts. So four of those. Big sprue with the... These are the doors that run along the top of... the top of the vehicle. These fold outwards. That's the rear of the vehicle. And there's a bulkhead here. And some control parts for the inside of the cab. The only problem I have with these is these long, thin doors actually slightly warped on this kit, which might mean, considering they're designed to be to open and close in the kit, they might actually not quite sit flat on the finished kit. So they might need to be a bit of coaxing, maybe some hot water or something. Then the pointy bits, Very nice sprue here of an SS-23 missile. The main body of the missile in two parts, so you will have a seam that runs all the way down the side, which you'll need to get rid of. This is the heated shroud that fits in the launch bay, and bits of the launcher. These nubs here actually fit into the missile. When it's built, you'll need to actually open up a couple of holes. So built on, fitted on the edges here, and these nubs will fit straight into it. Right, here's the cab. That's the cab floor and the dashboard minus instruments. That's the, I think that's just a basic radio set. Some very nice detail on it though. Sort of levers and things for the cab. Seats. And these are the thruster units that fit on the back and allow the vehicle to be driven and steered in the water. And the last sprue, which is the inside of the launch bay. And excuse me. Again, these are presumably these are round on the real vehicle. They're moulded here flat against the bay wall, so they're kind of half round. You might want to chop those off and fill the big gaps behind and remake them out of tube stock. And the same for all of the tubing as well. You might feel you want to chop that off there and rebuild it from brass wire or something, just to give it that extra bit of snap. You may of course feel that you really can't be bothered because it doesn't show that much. I might, depends how I feel when I come to build it, I might just want a quick build. And final thing I'm going to show you is just this very, very nicely rendered launch controls here. Lovely. Right, well that is the kit. It's an interesting kit. It does look like a very very nice kit to build. It's certainly an interesting subject, and I think Hobby Boss and Trumpeter are going Soviet vehicle crazy at the moment, so now is a good time I think to get these while they've still got that idea. And I'm probably going to build this after I've built the Scud. So I can build up a nice collection of Soviet tactical missiles. That's what the box lid looks like. Now the cost of these is, well, it's not too bad really. I think this one cost me £55 including delivery, which it's about, in dollars, it's probably about $70 or something. Perhaps a bit less, actually. It's probably about $60, $65, $63, something like that. So not an extortionate amount. I think it's going to be a very interesting model to have on one's shelf. It's certainly an unusual-looking vehicle. Like I say, it looks very Gerry Anderson. So I'm looking forward to building that. And I should say, while we're on the subject of the Trumpeter's desire to build every Soviet missile ever made, they have just announced actually an early Scud B. I think they might be pitching it as a Scud A, but the pictures I've seen actually are an early Scud B on the tracked chassis that was based on an ISU tank destroyer. So there is another one on its way, and that looks interesting. I shall probably try and get hold of one of those for review as well. Okay, well I hope you enjoyed this review. Like I said, it's an interesting and unusual vehicle, and will make an impressive model, I think. I will let you know as and when I get to it, but with the Scud currently on the workbench, I think that it's going to take a while before I actually do get to it. In the meantime, usual things apply. Please rate, comment, and subscribe. Let me know what you think. Until I have another kit to show you or another update, I will say thank you very much and goodbye.